that people live in magazines and video their sleeping casually. Where a cast of iron children are contemplating anarchy. It gets worse and worse after that.
Actually, it gets quite good. Spiritual Cowboys is a band, a soon-to-be-released album, and a concept of Eurythmic co-founder Dave Stewart. In his first solo work, Stewart calls for a return of meaning in music that he says has been lost to corporate rock and roll.
There used to be a sense of anarchy and also a feeling that you were telling the news, the alternative news, and you weren't shaking hands with the other side of the world, which was really just how much can we sell.
I saw my hero in Pepsi, overtaken in a gold mine. It's funny how money can make you deaf as well as blind.
The first single from the album, Party Time, is featured in the upcoming film Flatliners, a story about people intentionally drugging themselves into temporary death as they search for enlightenment. The song was not originally intended for use in a film.
I already had this song called Party Town, which was about a horrendous experimental drug party that I was at, where somebody ended up dying, drowning in a lily pond. And Joel Shoemaker was around my house, the director of Flatliners, and he heard this song and had a kind of semi-heart attack.
Actually, the director was just shocked at the parallels between Stewart's song and the thrill-seeking characters in the movie.
These people are, you know, they're after the ultimate sort of trip, the ultimate high, which is what it seems to me that America's trying to do at the moment. It's everybody's after the ultimate next sensation. And they think, oh, well, it must be death.
Dave Stewart's lyrics have always been sung by Annie Lennox. The Spiritual Cowboys marks the first time Stewart sings for himself.
I was totally unconfident about it. That's why I haven't made an album. You know, I'm 37 years old and this is my first solo album.
As for Eurythmics, who are currently on hold as Annie Lennox is taking some time off, Stewart is quite positive, both looking back at past achievements as well as considering the future.
I don't know anybody else who broke up from a relationship and then formed a partnership and that partnership went on to be hugely successful and still, you know, live around the corner from each other. And you know, I think we'll probably make a brilliant album sometime in the future.
Shining in your I just suggest if you're going to break into a song, just give us an extra 2 bars at the top for them to get set up.
Okay.
Do you want to play straight off and then we'll talk about what you're doing?
Don't worry about the mix. I got a vocal channel, so you're in channel one.
No.
Okay. So when did you start recording this album?
Have we started now?
Yeah, we're going.
Okay. Start again now.
When did you first start on this?
I started actually in hotel rooms about August, September last year. I had a little portable tape recorder, and was larger than a portable tape recorder. It was a 12-track machine. And I used to set it up in the top floor of hotels around the world, you know, and look out through the window at the city traffic and things, and compose songs. And some of that we actually used on the album. But the actual album I started around about February of this year.
So you were writing this back on the last tour?
Yeah, I wrote nearly all the songs during the last tour.
Did you flesh any of this out with Annie and the band at the time, or was this just off on
the roof? I did a couple of demos with the band, you know, in obscure places, like some far-flung Australian town, things like that.
Do you have a home studio? Do you produce at home?
I've got 5 studios, one in Los Angeles, 3 in a church in England, and 1 in the south of France.
And where did you record this?
None of those. No, I did actually. In some of it in the one in Los Angeles, some of it in the church, and a little bit in New York.
When you were writing and getting this together, was it Spiritual Cowboys in your mind yet? Was that a concept you had? Is it just a name? What is Spiritual Cowboys?
Well, Spiritual Cowboys is more significant than just a name. I think it's something I've been thinking about for a while, of what was missing in rock music in general, was a marriage of that outlaw, kind of wild outlaw characters, but with really strong words that meant something against this bombardment of corporate products that are forced down your throat, and especially in America. So I put the two together. It was a funny story, because when I put the two together, and I was really drunk with Harry Dean Stanton one night round at my house, and we were talking about the name and all the connotations that it meant, and the next day I had to go to Rio in Brazil to play some gigs, and I was telling Bob Dylan the name, who was in my hotel room, because he was doing some gigs too. And then later on that day, I went for my local voodoo shopping, you know, as you do, buying some devils and angels and things in this voodoo shop, and there was a Spiritual Cowboy, a real one, actually I didn't know existed, on the shelf amongst all the devils and the angels. There was this character, it was like a cowboy, you know, little pottery thing about this big. And I asked my interpreter, you know, what that one was, and he said, that is the Spiritual Cowboy in South America. It actually exists. And it's when they're having like Macumba, a voodoo ceremony, halfway through the ceremony, they bring out the Spiritual Cowboy right in the middle, and he's like at the crossroads of going into black magic and white magic. So it then gave me lots of ideas more about the band and how we are at the crossroads of a crisis in music at the moment. And I thought it was a great name for the band, so I stuck it all over my jacket, as you can see.
Now, did you already have the name together, and then you went to the store, and the guy called it?
That was what was really strange about it. I already had the name, the Spiritual Cowboys, and then I went to this voodoo store, and there was an actual, one of these images was called the Spiritual Cowboy.
You're talking about the corporate sound, of the corporate invasion of rock and roll, I guess, for lack of a better set of terms. There used to be more rock and roll in rock and roll.
Well, there used to be a sense of anarchy, and also a feeling that you were telling the news, the alternative news, and you weren't shaking hands with the other side of the world, which was really just how much can we sell to these unsuspecting general public, you know. So I'm dead against all of that, and it's in a lot of the songs on the album. I mean, there's one song called On Diamond Avenue, which is exactly about that. It's about the way that people in power impose a situation on the general public, and I can see it every time I walk down the street. You'll see a street full of jewelry shops and hotels and limousines, mixed with people begging, mixed with people drunk on the street, So that it's so jumbled up, the world now, and I think that all the spirituality has gone out of people and been replaced by nothing but Coca-Cola and Wheaties and things like this. And that's what all the songs on the album are about, really, including a one called Spiritual Love, which the last verse I say, well, it's all in the world we ever wanted, but it's those little things that become so big. And what I mean is, everybody just wants to be loved. But it gets further and further away the more people decide that they want all these other things that advertising companies are selling them instead. So you end up and you don't know your next door neighbour, and an old lady might die three flats above you and nobody knows for a week, and all these terrible things, you know.
Now, I'm assuming you didn't experience, or you don't experience, the Eurythmics as a situation where you're producing corporate music, but were you saving this for a separate project?
Oh no, we've been doing that in Eurythmics all the time. I mean, in fact, the first song we ever had a hit with, Sweet Dreams, is exactly about that. It's a sort of cynical way of saying, is this what, you know, our life's dream is made of, you know, just a complete rat race. That's why the video was me and Annie in a boardroom with cows walking around, and then the next thing we're in a field with our computers and we look completely out of place. Because, you see, cows and nature in general has just carried on totally the way it always was. And it's man that keeps trying to make the world perfect in his own mind, where it already was perfect, and all he's doing is ruining it, you know.
It's just a personal question. I've always wanted to know what the keyboard is that you're sitting at.
Oh, that's one of the first drum computers ever invented, called a movement audio computer, and it's very complex.
It looks simple. To come back to the theme of corporate music, it strikes me, and I'd like to ask how you got into writing a song for Flatlines, but it really comes to mind because I think there would be a lot of, it's a situation ripe maybe for compromise or having to get approval. How do you write a music for a movie?
I didn't write a song for it. What happened was a really strange piece of fate. I already had this song called Party Town, which was about a horrendous experimental drug party that I was at, where somebody ended up dying, drowning in a lily pond. And Joel Shoemaker was around my house, the director of Flatliners, and he heard this song and had a kind of semi-heart attack and pulled out this bit of footage that I'd been filming. And the two just completely meshed together, so it was never a thing where I was writing a song for the movie. And it even has lines in the song like, girls were drinking Novocaine to keep themselves amused, exactly as on his film. You know, when we put it on at random, at a random point, it happened that a girl was just drinking this chemical-looking thing, and just everything was in synchronicity, so.
So this is a second coincidence associated with...
Yeah.
Are there others?
Thousands. Absolutely thousands.
So when was the song in rough stage? Had you mixed it? Was it...
No, it was in a rough stage, but it was the same structure and everything. And we were in the middle of recording our album, so we just added on some horns, courtesy of Tower of Power, and did a rough mix of it and sent it to them, and they loved it. I like the idea of his film, you see, because I like the idea of these people, you know, they're after the ultimate sort of trip, the ultimate high, which is what it seems to me that America's trying to do at the moment. It's everybody's after the ultimate next sensation. And they think, oh, well, it must be death. You know, if you could die for, like, a short time and be brought back to life, then you must experience the most powerful hallucinations or whatever. But, of course, all you experience is all your karma of your life coming back to you and all the terrible things you might have done that you've even forgotten about hit you all in one go. And I've been writing a few songs about that subject anyway. So I thought it was an interesting subject.
Have you seen rushes from the film where the music is used?
Yeah, I mean, that's what I saw that night when he was playing me, you know, bits of rushes of the film. Yeah, it looks terrifying.
Now I'm wondering what lunatic kids in Oklahoma are going to run out and try to produce this for themselves.
Well, the thing is, you know, to me, any opportunity that I might get to put forward an alternative point of view, I'm going to use it, except anything to do with advertising products or, you know, being connected with something that has nothing to do with music and a message. But I think that the general message of this film is very positive. It makes you think about what you're doing in this lifetime, because everything you do in this lifetime is going to catch up with you, you know. It's like John Lennon said, instant karma's going to get you, you know.
Who plays on the album? Is this all you?
Oh no, I formed a little band, you know, called the Spiritual Cowboys, and in Britain everybody was writing, I'd formed a super group, and Mick Jagger was going to be singing, and all these various people were going to be playing, which all would have been possible and probably very good fun, but I thought, you know, I should have my own little garage band and make an album that is more real in a way. And so it's friends who, great musicians who, you know, we're all on the same wavelength, and it's a band that's going to tour and make more albums. And
is this the band that played the Cat Club with you?
That's right, yeah.
So I counted three guitars up there, which I haven't seen in a while.
Two drummers, yeah.
Did you write it that way? Is that an offshoot of how you produce or hear music?
Well, you know, I make so many different kinds of records, but the record that I want to make of my own was a record that brought my own guitar playing more to the fore, because for years it's been kind of suppressed. And I always was a guitar player, and I always wrote on the guitar. And so when we play live, having the other two guitars means I can sing, and when I want a solo, the whole bottom doesn't drop out, I can just solo over the top. And having two drummers is great as well, because it makes complete sort of wild rhythms that aren't just so clear cut and set. You can have something that, if it wants to build, it builds to ridiculous proportions, because they're, it's like having, you know, Ginger Baker times three or something, you know.
The idea of multiple drummers just gets real big. You see, you were playing quite a bit of guitar on the last Eurythmics tour. That I remember you out there making a lot of noise.
Yeah, it's a different kind of thing though, you know, because in Eurythmics song, the whole focus, I'm trying to make everything go to Annie as the focus point, and that's the way the songs are arranged. And because Annie is singing, and when she's not singing, she's not playing an instrument, then we try to make it not many gaps when she's not singing, you see. Whereas if you're a guitarist and a singer in a band like Clapton, for instance, you can actually stop and play for a minute and a half or whatever and not be self-conscious about anything, because you've got a guitar, you know, it's your strength.
Is this a good time to play something from the coming album?
I just sing a couple of little extracts. John Lennon was like a really powerful influence on my life as well as music, and I knew that I had to have one song dedicated to him on the album, and this song's a song I wrote about his killer, so it's called The Devil's Just Been Using You. You're scratching on my back door. I could smell what you come here for. You brought your politics in blue, and your phony piece of paper too. Yeah, you'll be shaking in your shoes when I tell everybody the news. The devil's just been using you. 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 Extract from it. I sing a bit about Diamond Avenue, because I get a good dig at Margaret Thatcher, you know. And people who musicians who do deals with corporate companies like Coca-Cola. So it goes. $100 men laughing, only 2. to understanding. Hey, we had a spinning for good and for evil. There's a church bell ringing, but there's nobody listening, except the beggars in the doorways of designer perfection. And there's a thin man collecting for a government problem. He spends a long time waiting with that look of disapproval. And there's icicles forming in the agency windows, but there's nothing for sale there, only dreams and oblivion. The mysteries that are discussed in the beds of the kings and queens. The misery, well, it brings you down like a recurring dream. Here on the Diamond Avenue. And there's a tightrope marriage between the doctor and the junkie. In daylight it's perfect, but at night time it's frightening. And the hospital must move, so the hotel could profit. But nobody stood up there to curse it or to mock it. And there's hi-fi conditions now, arranged for my transport. But there's nothing to hear, except the sound of bloody progress. And the hotels are blushing from the interest they're earning. But the tables and the chairs on the bomb sites are burning. The mysteries that are discussed in the beds of the kings and the queens. The misery, well, it brings you down like a recurring dream. You are on the Diamond Avenue. I saw Thatcher and Murdoch, those twins of confusion, pay Saatchi and Saatchi to keep up their little illusion. I saw my hero and Pepsi both digging in a gold mine. It's funny how money can make you deaf as well as blind. The mysteries that are discussed in the beds of the kings and queens. The misery, well, it brings you down like a recurring dream. You are on the Diamond.
You are on the Diamond Avenue. Very nice. Maggie Thatcher's taking a beating on the radio. Have you heard Sinead's song? Black Boys on Mopeds?
No.
Margaret Thatcher on TV, shocked by the deaths that occurred in Beijing. Seems strange she should be offended. The same orders are given by her.
Mm-hmm.
Which is...
It's not just singling her. It's just general, same as don't follow leaders, basically, you know.
Regain my composure. Where were we just before you played? We were talking about touring and the band, and this is the band that you were in the city with. When are you touring?
Well, I'm going to do some warm-up dates late August, September, and then I'm going to play September, October, November, and a bit of December, and then start again in January through to June or July next year.
Do you know what it says? Are you looking to do small places, or are you looking to carry this as
yeah, so some clubs, some things a bit bigger than clubs. I like the fact that the audience can jam in and see something that's real, you know, a close-up and an assault of words on their minds. And the fact that the band is very dynamic and sort of wild to look at, it's quite good the first time people see it right close-up.
Do you have anything else going on right now? Are you producing anybody or stuff on the side?
Yeah, I'm just busy finishing mixing a band on my own label, London Beat, and I just produced another band on my own label called The Flame. And I've got a TV series that I made myself coming out in Britain. I don't know when it's coming out in America, a music program. It's about a businessman played by David Rappaport, who unfortunately killed himself not long ago. And he's completely addicted to power. And his secretary sends him off on a little journey in a car, bit like a Carlos Castaneda journey, and to discover more things about himself. And on the way he meets everybody from K.D. Lang to George Clinton to Harry Dean Stanton to, and these people, because of the way they are and what they're singing or talking about, transform him till in the end he ends up in a church with Little Richard, and he gets completely transformed.
What just happened? Let's change tapes.
And have a mixture of the two. How did it sound on your thing? Was the balance okay?
Just roll when you're ready. Okay. Is this pretty much how you write? Just sort of sitting and...
Yeah. I always find that the way I write songs tends to be that I'm in a certain mood and the song just comes through me rather than me sitting down trying to work out chords. So it would be probably the process takes about 5 minutes, the length of the song. I would probably play the song from beginning to end as if it was written, but it's just actually being written at the time.
Why don't you give me an extreme close-up right now? Yeah, like that. When you do write like that, do you have an idea and you're pursuing it, or is it more like a...
No, it's more instinctive, you know. I might just hit a certain chord like that, and then I get a sort of feeling off the sound of it, and then it goes... And the rest of it just starts coming out like a song. It's like the beginning of Here Comes the Rain Again.
So you find out...
I got your pad in there.
That's... All right, I'll take what you got. So you find out what the song is when everyone else does, I guess, when you're done.
Yeah, and usually, you know, words start coming in a kind of subconscious way. So you might just be messing around like... So I've picked up the kind of... Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Then you go... Hey, prima donna with ya. Suicidal kiss. The pocketbook religion in ya. Words come out.
How much material did you write for this album?
About 74, 75 songs. And I recorded about 27 of them. But I still have loads that I haven't recorded. It's just a matter of time, because the recording process takes longer, then you've got to mix them.
And how many are we going to make the album?
Well, you can only fit about 14 on a CD, 72 minutes, you know.
So... How do you choose from 74 songs?
I don't know. We have arguments about it all the time up here at Arista and over the phone to London. You know, everybody chooses different songs. And in the end, it's just like the ones that feel like hang together, you know, run into each other.
Do you ever surprise yourself in the studio with, one thing I noticed when I saw you on the last tour, some of the songs that have been highly produced on the albums and you played them on acoustic guitar worked and were wonderful and were very different.
Yeah. Well, I think that's the whole thing about writing songs, is that you should be able to sing it, you know, with a piano or a guitar, and it should stand up. You know, there are other kind of records that are just grooves or rapping everything. That's perfectly valid, and that's a different art form, but actually songwriting... you know, constructing songs to be sung with melodies. You should be able to sing them with a piano or an acoustic guitar. I can sing any of the ones off my album like that. And it's kind of a bit comforting, you know, a bit secure as well. Because if you have a song that's just... It's not really a song that's just hung together by technology, then that's when you're talking about the lip-syncing thing, you know? I mean, a lot of bands that go around with computers and lip-syncing, it's because there isn't really a song... And it isn't really a singer, and there isn't any message at all. So all they're doing is kind of an entertaining show with dancing and whatever, and if that's what you're into, well, that's fine. But for me, I just find that like a big, giant chocolate cake that's all rich on the outside, but nothing in the middle, you know?
Okay, but in your case, where you've accomplished very much in the studio with a song that already hung together, and so I'm wondering, you walk in with 75 songs that you can sing on a piano or a guitar, mm-hmm. and then, I mean, do you know where you're headed?
Well, all my songs are basically about a similar thing, you know, which is about the world, the way I see it, and, you know, whether it's Diamond Avenue or love shines on everything, or a spiritual love, or fashion balm, or whatever they are, they're all got a similar attitude, and it's the attitude that hangs it together. It's a bit like Lou Reed with his album Transformer, you know. You're on the same album, you've got Vicious, Satellite of Love, what else is on there? Walk on the Wild Side, they're all completely different, you know. New York Conversation. And yet, as soon as his voice comes in, you know it's him.
So, were there any songs on this album that once you actually started recording them, maybe you changed substantially, you started to hear it a different way and decided to use
the studio? Yeah, there was one called King of the Hypocrites, which I recorded in a kind of normal rock way. And then I sort of heard it should be different and made it a bit more. It's got a kind of funk behind it, and then it's got like kind of Hendrix wah-wah-y guitars on top, and yet I kept the vocals really straight, so it's this sort of strange juxtaposition, which was like the hypocrisy of the song. Yeah.
What's it been like working with your vocals as the lead vocals?
Well, I was totally unconfident about it. That's why I haven't made an album. You know, I'm 37 years old, and this is my first solo album, and I've made albums with so many people. And it was Chris Thomas, the record producer, who gave me the confidence. He came around my house one day, and he heard a demo that was on. And usually I don't like anybody to hear my demos on my voice. And he didn't know it was me, and he just said, "Oh, I really like this song. Who's it singing?" And I said it was me. And he said, "Oh, I'd love to make it into a record with you if you want some help." And I thought that was a good idea, because, you know, he could stand on the other side of the control room, and he gave me so much confidence in the studio, and by about 2 weeks of working with him, I felt like as if I'd been singing all my life, you know. And then, you know, he worked with me another 4 weeks, and I went and recorded some more on my own.
Did you find you treated or used the vocals differently than you might if when you were working with Annie? Mm.
Well, I didn't used to sing with Annie hardly at all. I mean, an occasional backing vocal, and that was it.
I'm thinking more in terms of you've done a lot of stuff on the albums with Annie's vocals.
Oh, do you mean producing her vocals? Yeah, well, that was the funny thing, you know, because I would often sing to her all of the lots of melodies and how to express itself in her voice, but also a lot of the ad-libs. You know, when an ad-lib came up, I'd go, yeah, you know, how I thought it should be. And after years of doing that, I suddenly found myself doing it to myself, you know, which was odd. But I had great fun doing it, and I'm still discovering things about my voice, you know. It's interesting. It's a new thing.
How do you think this album is going to be received out there? Who's it for?
Well, I think it's for all the people who feel disorientated and alienated from music that's happening at the moment, and the way that music has been programmed into such sections, like, you know, whether it's dance or R&B or pop. I think this is an album from the old school of albums where you buy it and you can get into it on all sorts of different levels, and that it's kind of timeless in a way.
Are there any other songs you want to play for us?
I can play snippets of things.
Wait a second.
Let's do that. Okay. The sound, I'm really liking the sound. Yeah, I think this is a good idea.
Okay. Okay. This is another song about that. I'll just sing bits and verses, otherwise you've got too much stuff. It's another song about the world in general. Stick around and take it in. The more you see, the closer we'll be. I visualize us falling from the towers of the 20th century, where people live in magazines, on video they're sleeping casually, where a cast of iron children are contemplating anarchy. It gets worse and worse after that. The words go deeper and deeper into one's subconscious.
Are you writing now?
Hmm?
Are you writing?
At this very moment.
this week.
I was actually writing at this very moment in the back of my mind. That's why I got confused when I was singing that song. Yeah, I mean, I was writing, just wrote it on the other day. It was, because... I haven't really finished it, so I'll just bluff it. Why did you follow me here? Tell me why did you follow me here? Long white fingers offering me a cure on a table made of glass. You know.
Great. Are you doing any work or planning or thoughts about the Eurythmics when they come back together?
Well, not now, because we haven't sort of a year and a half, 2 years sabbatical. You know. I'm just doing this. But my life doesn't really change from day to day. I sort of get up, stagger around looking for something, breakfast or something, and within half an hour I've probably got hold of the guitar, and then, you know, people ring up and people come round, or I go somewhere and writing songs or in the studio, or it's all orientated around music, you know.
Could you run down, just for the record, on camera, what the current status of the Eurythmics is?
Well, we've made 8 albums in about 8.5-9 years, and Annie, you know, unfortunately lost her baby on the day the baby was due, not long ago, and I think she would like to get a sort of family life in order and have some time off, and I don't blame her. And we respect each other very much, and we've done so much together, you know, been together for like 14, 15 years, and we lived with each other, and then we made all these records together, and I think it's pretty miraculous achievement. I don't know anybody else who broke up from a relationship and then formed a partnership, and then the partnership went on to be hugely successful and still, you know, live around the corner from each other, and you know, I think we'll probably make a brilliant album sometime in the future.
Do you see doing a second album with Spiritual Cowboys?
Oh yeah, Satan. About 25 at this rate. Otherwise I'll never be able to use up all my songs.
Well, I'm covered for this. I'd just like to ask you two things. What's the current status of the Rock and Romania thing and your involvement? How did that come?
Oh, that was, I was in the middle of the album and I was talking to Olivia Harrison, George Harrison's wife, on the phone about something else. And I suggested, why don't you, I'll record this track and people can ring up a certain telephone number in Britain and they'll hear it down the phone for 50 pence or something, and that would go to the charity. And the next thing I heard is she took that further, and George had said, oh well, Wilbury's will do a track, and so somebody else said they'd do a track, so she rang me up and I said, okay, I'll do another track as well as this one, so I did two. And I had to write one on the spot, which was called This Week, and it's kind of play on words because it says This Week Little Baby later on. And that's on the Romanian charity album. There's always things like that happening, running parallel, you know.
I mean, did you just get a call? What drew you to that, or how come you decided to get involved?
Well, I'm always prone to wanting to help certain situations, you know, whether it's earthquake victims or... And because I know George very well and Olivia, and she was getting involved, I knew that it would be a very genuine thing that would happen, that something good would come out of it. So my response in that situation was always yes, you know.
And then the last thing I'd like to ask, as I mentioned before, Jimi Hendrix died 20 years ago,
yeah,
this coming September, and I'm just wondering what thoughts you had, or meaning the way he played guitar, his music, you know, meant to you, or do you think it's hype that some people think he's like the greatest guitarist ever?
Oh, he's absolutely stunningly brilliant, and what was brilliant about him was the guitar played him rather than he played the guitar. And the guitar in his hands just looked like some wild animal out of control, and he was desperately trying to control it, like, you know, when they have these chariots with horses and you're trying to pull them back. That's what it was like, and you know, it's genius.
I have the same image. That's wild. Is there something you'd like to address? I'm complete here. something that you want to talk about this album that I didn't...
Not really.
I think you hit a lot of great things.
A lot of things.
I needed to just get something for a postmodern.
We need to get the postmodern idea.
What I was going to ask is, love shines to me. I spent 3 days on the track.
Oh, yeah.
Something about that song. I know it might be fun, if you did something like music with love shines.
Play a bit of it and then turn it into the video or something.
And then turn right into the introduction for postmodern.
I just have to work it out a bit.
Okay, well, you know what? When you got work,
turn it from that song to the video.
Just do it straight, looking at the camera, when you get out of the way.
Disappointed, cold and weary day. Yeah, I think I can work it out.
The name of the show is Postmodern.
Postmodern,
and you could do it just how I'm Dave Stewart. You're watching Postmodern as you come out of the song.
I don't know, that might be a bit naff, because it might look like I'm singing the song to... It'd be better if I just played it and then did this separate.
Whatever,
and then you could try and... You could do some crossfade of it into the video.
Why don't we think of it?
Yeah, it's just it's on a piano, so I have to work out the chords on the guitar first. Then. Disappointed on a cold and weary day. All the little angels have all left and gone away. Crystal is the water that's running down your face. It's pale just like the moonlight. Say that. Pale just like the moonlight. I'm a sad and lonely place.
Sorry, did it wrong.
It's piano chords. Disappointed on a cold and weary day. All the little angels have all left and gone away. Crystal is the water that's running down your face. It's pale just like the moonlight on a sad and lonely plain. Broken hearted with reason to be. A cruel and twisted blow from whichever way you see. Man was made to suffer and a woman left to grieve. It makes it hard for even the strongest to believe. Love shines on everything. Love shines on you. Love shines on every little thing. Every little thing you do.
For postmodern, I think you should just do a straight intro.
Yeah.
And then into the song or whatever.
Well, are they going to go into... I can sing a bit of Party Town if they're going to go into that.
Yeah, they are.
Okay.
They are. The ballad with the baseball begins crying.
Then you're watching MTV Postmodern or Postmodern MTV, and this is my new video.
Okay. I'm just singing a different key line. I'm just like, saxophone to play a little cool out line. Hi, this is David Alan Stewart of Eurythmics and now the Spiritual Cowboys, and you're watching Postmodern. Coming up soon is my video, Party Town. Saxophones are playing in a pool of light. Corridors and mirrors in a never-ending night. Jukebox electric shining in your face. Arms like a gorilla playing a stumbling bass. That's enough, isn't it? Take the first two lines and...
It don't get much better than that.
We have one last. The same idea, it's for the Weekend Rock. I would have you play
four bars of the same song, stop, look up at the camera and say, it's the Week in Rock, or I'm Dave Stewart, or whatever. Just hold them. Solid shot.
Is that okay?
Yep. No, 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 no. I like your idea. Check that. Start with the guitar.
Okay. When you're ready. God.
Yeah, it was great.
I was thinking about the weekend party.
It's the Weekend Rock.
Okay. Again?
And feel comfortable if you want to say your name. Otherwise, I'll chiron on you.
Okay. Ready? Party town, party town. Do you want to do it again?
Yeah.
Okay, we gotta change
tape there.
Okay, we'll get it on
there. Yeah. On this, and then we're home.
Anytime.
Party town, party town. I saw you with your dress torn down. In party town, party town. You were naked and alone. It's the Week in Rock.
Brilliant.
Okay?
They got it.